the sun goes down and the moon comes up. I turn into a teenage Goo Goo Mop. You better duck when I show up. The Goo Goo Mop.
Yo! It's 8:11 Texas time on a Friday night. I know nobody's listening because y'all are all zooming, but I got a shot of hot rock and roll for you anyway. Kale, a Red River rock and roll request.
What is Stretch? It's the buzz again.
Oh, not again. Hang it up, lame-o. Go call your mother.
Dirty. Well, this is for Rick the Prick. He wants to hear Bright Lights, Big Titties.
Wrong. I don't want to hear it. I want to see it.
Cool. Welcome back. Like I said, three of these in a row, just complete utter nonsense. But anytime something topical happens, like Texas Chainsaw Massacre being released to fucking Netflix,
we have our finger on the pulse.
Yeah, we do. You know, we got our ear to the streets. You know, the kids. You know, when I talk to the kids on the street, they're like, "Yo, what's up with that TCM episode?" I'm like, "Yo." I'm like, we might have to give them some of that. So, you know, RRP, once again, we out here. And today we're going to talk about Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2022. Another sequel. This one's a little interesting. You know, like I did a rewatch on this. And so before we get into our rankings, let's just talk about this movie because there's a lot to really talk about. So I've seen it two times. Parker, how many times have you seen it?
Two times. I watched it the night it came out, and then I just watched it again Wednesday.
I found that I liked it more the second time around. Did you find that or not so much?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't. I guess I liked it just as much. I mean, I really did enjoy this movie. I was happy to see that my attention span lasted the second time. Picked up a couple new things this time, but I really dug it.
Yeah, me too. There's certain things that I picked up on, certain plot decisions and character development that I was like, oh, okay, like I see kind of like what they were going with. Langan, how many times?
I watched it twice when it came out, and I watched it again last night. I didn't really like it.
Yeah,
the first time at all. The second time was a little better.
Yeah, what made it better?
I don't know. I, you know, we'll get into dissecting and stuff, but you know, I'm not like a lot of people like really shitting on it, like really hard. I'm not like there, you know what I mean? And I get people that said it was fun. The kills were A plus kills. Great violence.
Yeah.
Fantastic. I just thought the story and script was like really lazy. Like,
you know, it was super lazy in certain parts and kind of really thought out in other parts. I gotta say, I know that there was two directors attached to it, like Ryan Tohill and his brother. I think they only had one directing credit underneath the dig they had under their belt, and somehow I guess like the stuff that they were shooting didn't really impress the studio. So then they got this dude, David Blue Garcia, who also, once again, he only directed one movie called Tejano in 2018, but he's a cinematographer, which explains, let me shut this fucking phone off, which explains why I think the movie looks fucking gorgeous. Like the cinematography on this is great. Like the artsy looking flower thing. You know, it's funny, a guy like this, being a cinematographer, probably took that shot so serious with like the the flower shot with like the net, and like leave it to horror fans to just make a meme out of that and just kind of like shit on it. But I thought in particular that was gorgeous, and I didn't know that he was a cinematographer, which makes a lot of sense to me.
Yeah,
you know, so he takes the film over. He did cinematography also on a movie called Bloodfest, which I thought was pretty good too. And then the writing, the screen, the actual story came from Fede Alvarez, which this dude rules, man. He wrote this. He wrote a bunch of stuff. He wrote Don't Breathe, which we all liked.
Yep.
He did the screenplay and directed the Evil Dead remake,
mm-hmm.
which is funny because in one of the kills here was reminiscent of you know, like the when the black dude got his like jaw sliced open.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It reminded me of that Evil Dead kill with the girl that got her fucking, you know.
True.
And John Larroquette, man, they dug him up, huh?
Brought him back. It. Yeah.
He sounds great.
Well, yeah. You know, there were certain stabs at an obvious stab, which I thought was, you know, as far as like, you know, some kind of continuity in a franchise that probably out of the big four we talk about has the least amount of continuity at all. It's from film to film.
That's saying a lot.
Yeah, that's, I know, because the other ones, you know, are real liberal with it anyway. This one, if you watch, and I rewatched the part one all the way through in chronological order to the other one, to the recent one last night. Just, I like to do that and watch the progression. And
you're an animal.
Yeah, I'm gonna, and I just did that in October, I think, when we did the big four thing. But you know, it, there is nothing, like there's such loose strands, like tying like a lot of some things, not at all. And now in this movie took a step. Larroquette, you have in there. I thought the whole thing with bringing that girl back, Sally.
That was the biggest crowbar, which I think we all are going to agree with that, where it was like, after the movie, I thought to myself, imagine a movie where that didn't happen. Like, it's almost like you could have called it Texas Showdown. You could have called it The Outsiders.
Totally.
Or
hipster,
something.
Hipster Ghost Town.
Yeah.
Part like, one. Like, I don't, you know, it was just, it could have been anything and stuff. And it, she was just so unnecessary to like pull the, and to like, and you don't even have the cool aspect of the, you know, the original actress who had passed. So it makes it even more of a crowbar, you know, and she's got to take down the Polaroid to look at it like twice, just to make sure, hey, remember, this has some tie in to something. Yeah. It's a picture of Franklin.
Yeah.
Didn't even say his name at some point, you know? So there were certain things like that, that, you know.
And I wonder if you know, so these studios always test out films. And I think originally they called it Texas Chainsaw the Beginning, and it didn't test well with audiences.
And they already did that.
Texas Chainsaw the Beginning.
Oh, they dropped the massacre.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
Well, that's probably why it didn't test well. So then from there, they just called it Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And I almost feel like I didn't do enough investigating to find out if they tacked on like that the Sally angle.
It seemed like it was tacked on. And maybe after the success of the Halloween franchise, then people make the tie on, which makes a lot of sense. You know what I mean? And just like the Halloween too, when Halloween 2018 came out and they called it Halloween, but it was actually kind of a sequel to Halloween.
Yeah.
This is called Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but it acts as a sequel to Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
And it's really, you know, like when you talk about continuity, so let's go through them. So like one goes into two, mm-hmm. right? And then you get to three, which is just this weird anomaly that has like different characters. Like you know the character so well in one and two, and then three comes out and it's completely like just the most random assortment of, like, you have like Viggo Mortensen, then you have this other dude, and then you have a mom, and then you have a little kid. It's like watching Married with Children when they threw seven in. You're just like, what the fuck is going on right here?
Explanation.
Yeah, and then you get to four, which vanished, but I guess they brought it back, which same thing. It was just like this like weird assortment of characters, and that's where it really ended, right? I think, right? And then they went straight to the remake.
Yep.
And then the remake did the beginning, and it's like, okay, so those two things kind of go together after three and four are fucking out in limbo. And then what I didn't realize until we were doing research for this episode was 3D and 2017 are together. So 2017 is the prequel to 3D. And I was like, oh my God, I'm like, that makes so much fucking sense. And then you end up with this one that, I mean, I guess it kind of continues from that.
I don't know. I thought it was, I didn't, feel that it was tied in with 3D or that. I thought it was more like a direct sequel in a way, but a direct sequel with a lot of time has passed.
Oh, direct sequel. It's a direct sequel to the first one. You're right.
Right. Like nothing happened since that, you know, the Sally, the original events, you know, that Larroquette tells us and stuff. And then we get to this, which would also, if we look at her, Leatherface would be like a freaking 85 years old. Are we going to believe that Leatherface has supernatural element like Jason? That's how they wrote that. Listen, he's supernatural.
Yeah, no,
Leatherface isn't supernatural. No, supernatural
and even with that, like I could overlook that. I could just overlook that timeline. And all right, so let's get into the movie because like I'm going to really say what I thought kind of worked. You watch like Out of Towners, like in a way, there was like a lot of like red herrings, you could say, or like things that were about to like take, like, you know, like yeah, the guy at the gas station that you're like, oh, maybe this guy is like the new hitchhiker. The cops pulling the kids over. It's like, oh, they're probably going to like harass them. And none of those things happened. And I like that. I like that they were kind of like, in a way, not that the real estate entrepreneur kids were the villains, but it was sure kind of, it's sure kind of like skewed that way, you know?
These real estate entrepreneurs that bought this town and they hired one contractor to fix it for a showing and they've never been there and they didn't even know the contractor apparently because of the incident at the gas station.
They ran into him three times before they saw him there.
We need you to fix this town up in a week that we're going to sell.
And he's fixing on someone's car. I'm like, who in this town drives? Like, it's just like you're in the
middle. Apparently they have Tesla charging ports all up and down that remote area.
But, you know, once again, like if it was anything else, like, you know, let me talk about casting. Like the girls seem fine. The dude Dante, like it didn't bother me. But then you get to like that guy, Richter, which is the guy we're talking about, the contractor. Mm-hmm. This dude looks like he's playing someone. Like it's just so ridiculous. Like, I don't know. Like what I liked about some of those earlier films is they get like the ugliest people. And this guy looks like he came out of like, you know, like a jeans commercial or something.
Oh, yeah. Or even going back to part three, like Vigo is way and Matthew McConaughey and four, they're way too good looking to be in this family.
Yeah. Perfect teeth, but, you know? but I feel like they grease them up pretty good too. Like,
this
guy really not so much.
But even too, at the from the gas station to when they get to the town, because I know a lot of people like, you know, talked about this was going to be the woke. Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Who told you that though? Like
it became a thing because of the trailer that leaked on the bus and the phones those people look and stuff like that. And then here in like 8 minutes we have like I think gun control, school shootings, emissions from the truck and a Confederate flag in about the first 8 minutes of the movie.
But the thing that didn't bother me was that was the way in, but as the movie unfolded, that guy was more of an ally than he wasn't. That girl turned into more of a badass and she like was gravitated towards him. You know what I mean? Like, like that part of it I liked. Even the girl when they realize, when they go into the house and I guess like the guy, you know, the old lady who's taking care of Leatherface, she said that she talked to the bank and I guess she squared it all away and all these things were unfolding. Hey, let me tell you another thing too. I'm going to bring up 3D real quick because that movie was 90 minutes and this movie was 83 and that movie felt way longer for some reason. Maybe just the character development was like kind of like a little bit more fleshed out. This one seemed to go so fast that it felt like it really felt like the last 80 minutes of a movie after 30 minutes played out. But they're
moved. Yeah.
They're roughly the same time. I don't know what happened.
That 3D is just, it's atrocious. It's atrocious.
So you did a rewatch?
Yeah, and against my better judgment, because I knew how much I hated it, but I was like, when I commit to like doing this chronological, I commit, you know what I'm saying? But with the exception of the of that girl who's still fine playing the lead, it's unwatchable.
Yeah. Did you do a rewatch on that one?
I didn't. I rented it from the library. I remember when it first came out, and then I went to find the streaming or something, and it was nowhere. And I kind of did the same thing. I was like, oh man, I was like that hot chick, the main chick. So and then that hot chick from Lost was in it too. And I was just like, eh, that's good enough. That's what I'll remember about that movie.
Yeah.
Listen, the only thing that you could, the thing that puts that movie in like the complete toilet is the do your thing. Cause when she throws him the chainsaw,
that
line will live in horror infamy as one of the worst things I've ever heard.
Oh my God. That line was so fucking bad. That line was like, just imagine if you're a fan of the franchise, if you're a fan and you're writing, like, that's why I'm thinking like, yo, you can't be, no real fan would ever write that in a movie and think to themselves like, this is going to be good. The audience is going to love, like, it's just so fucking bad.
But, this is going to be my hasta la vista, baby. This is going to be my catchphrase.
So on a rewatch, I didn't hate it as much as I did the first time, 3D. I just want to say that. But so you have like, Sarah Yarkin, who was in Happy Death Day to You. And then her sister, Elsie Fisher. I forgot the character's name, but yeah, you know, I thought they were fine. They had a great dynamic. Once it really started kicking off was when I guess they were in that cop car, right? You know, the old lady had like a heart attack or something. And I always say this, if your plot is going to be terrible, give me pure violence. And this movie gave me pure violence. And I feel like it started there, right? Like when he snapped the cop's wrist and, you know,
stabbed him with it.
Yeah.
Well, that's what it had going for it. Great violence. And it kept it because the script was bad. They kept it at a short running time. So it doesn't like, I don't feel even though I'm not like gung ho about it, I don't put it, it's way better than 3D or part four was, you know, but light years better than that. Played to its strengths.
For sure. Absolutely. And you know, what I'll say about this movie as well is when was the last time you heard anyone talk about a Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie, that a brand new movie? Like, when was the last time?
It's the beginning, probably.
You know, but Facebook wasn't even a thing, though.
No. The beginning, meaning the one that came out with Lee R. Ermey.
I'm saying
that's the last one that had a lot of hype. I thought, you know, 3D kind of came and went, and let the one in 2017 or whatever. I don't even think I knew that came out.
No one even fucking talked about that movie.
Steven Dorff.
Seriously, Parker, when was the last time anyone?
This one. That's the one you're talking about.
I'm going to get to that because I love that movie. Parker, seriously, your timeline. I don't know. Maybe you know more adults than I do. But like,
No. I mean, it's probably the same thing. I mean, the last time that I was really kind of hyped on one was probably the remake. That was the last time that, you know, I got people like talking about it or whatever. I mean, when it comes to like my big thing with this one was like going back to like Sally, like I kind of hate it when movies don't reference or like at least like think about like the old ones. Like, so like in the second one, like they bring up Sally real quick and she became catatonic, they say. And then like even in like part three, they talk about how like she died in like a healthcare facility. But like in this one, it's just like she's full of piss and vinegar. She's got her fucking pump action shotgun and she's ready to go. But like casting wise, I mean, just you bring back John Larroquette as the narrator. I mean, holy shit, the sheriff was fucking Lieutenant Gorman from fucking Aliens. Hello. Love
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
I mean, the mother. I mean, whatever you want to call it, the woman that raised fucking Leatherface was the fucking woman from Sleepwalkers, which I think is one of Stephen King's fucking most slept on movies.
Ha!
You know, so
maybe too many dead cats. That's what.
Yeah.
Me.
You know, I loved, you know, him wearing her face as the mask. I mean, like just don't, I don't know. I really dug this movie. I mean, it, like you said, like very violent. So maybe that's what it was with me. Just a lot of great kills, you know,
that scene in particular. So like when shit kicks off, you know, he gets the guy in the back, stabs his neck, and then like, you know, shoots or somebody, I guess he accidentally shoots the cop in the front. And they're sitting there and you're like, fuck, what is she going to do? They're both stuck there and you see Leatherface doing something. And it took a minute to realize, I was like, oh, yeah, he's cutting. I thought he was cutting the other cop's face, but I guess it was the old lady, which would make sense. And then he comes over and the cop moves and he bashes him in the head with a fucking like,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Log or something. You're like, damn.
Yeah.
And you know that, like, you're like, OK, it makes sense why she took the ride, because she's probably going to be the first one who gets killed. But you're like, maybe she won't. But there's no escaping this whatsoever. And the way he kills her, fucking very violent.
Yeah.
Very fucking violent. And from that moment on, I'm like, all right, I guess he's just going to walk back because, yeah, he's a big dummy and doesn't know anything. So he's just going to
drive.
Yeah, he can't drive. Yeah, he can't just take that fucking ambulance or whatever the fuck it is and goes back. And then from there, it's just one of the redeeming qualities, too, is when Melody is talking to Dante, you know, the two people that bought that property. She was like, OK, the old lady died and she wanted to just make sure that it was bullshit that the bank gave her back her property. Because she's like, I just want to be on the right side of history of this. Which is also a funny phrase. And it turns out that the bank did, you know, and they were at that moment in time, like you kind of like, I like that angle where it's like, oh, these people came and they kind of fuck shit up. Because even when the cops pulled them over, like you're like, oh, they're going to fuck with them. Are they going to do something? Because you have that Texas Chainsaw Massacre, beginning and the other one where like, what's the fucking Marine?
Arlie Emery.
Yeah. So he's like, obviously the bad guy. So you think that's what's going to happen. You don't. And then they ended up just being like, hey, you know, it's our town. Just be nice to it. And you're like, oh, okay. Like they're going to be normal. Love all the stuff that was going on. You know, when Dante gets his face hacked off, but you don't even see it.
Yeah.
You don't see it till later on. Then you see like, you're like, oh shit, he cleavered up his whole fucking jaw. And then from there, it's just, you know, it's just a matter of like, you know, everyone getting it. And I really thought the main character was going to get it. Melody.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that sledgehammer kill on that dude's head when she was under the bed.
The leg was the first thing.
The leg was the best. That was the best scene in the entire movie, I thought.
Yeah. You know, because you're like, you're thinking like, okay, maybe he's going to help them. He's like some sort of protagonist. And man, did he get it fucking bad, you know?
The hammer to the head was a la part two, you know? That was incoming mail, you know, I think.
Oh, yeah.
But he went a step further.
He
went
a flat net thing. Yeah. And what was the effects on it? This was
practical.
I mean, it was a lot of practical. Is it the CGI mainly? Or what? No, have you read anything about that?
Yeah, they decided to go all practical.
Okay. Yeah. Even on the bus and stuff with the...
The bus, I didn't really
like when he
look.
Cut that guy's, you know, I'm jumping ahead a little bit, when he cut down the shoulder of that one guy and that girl that he cut in half with her intestines.
I mean, that stuff, yeah, I'm sure 90% of it was practical, but for stuff like that, yeah.
That's cool. I didn't know it was that, all right.
You know, but like, yeah, and from there, I feel like the movie just kind of like, it was just off to the races, you know, you knew, and it must have, like, I wonder what the budget was, because it was just this one setting kind of, and it looked like they went to like Universal Studios and borrowed a block or something, you know, like it's just, it's like
where they shoot the Wild Wild West stunt spectacular.
Yeah. They went to Tucson.
I'm looking up the young Jamie right now is looking up the budget on this film while you guys are speaking here.
But yeah. And then from there, just, you know, everything was great. The bus was a lot of fun because it just allowed, you know, when you watch a movie like this, it's all about the kills. And sometimes, you know, you're like, oh, it was only three kills, four kills. It's like watching Batman, like the old TV show. And there's like two goons. You're like, yeah, that's kind of sucked. But when they, you know, when Mr. Freeze has eight goons and they're all fighting each other, I'm like, this is so much better. So he jumps on this fucking bus. And the Asian dude was like, hey, man, we're filming. You don't want to get canceled.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought that was funny.
Touch me, you're canceled.
Yeah, I thought that was super funny for sure.
I thought that was the first time that Texas Chainsaw kind of jumped into the funny Nightmare on Elm Street. Like, now you're playing with power, kind of. Because like, if you were reading the tweets or whatever the hell he was on, like people were saying this looks so fake. I would never go there. Blah blah blah. So I thought that was pretty funny.
Yeah, yeah, but it wasn't overtly. Where Nightmare on Elm Street did, like, right, there was out of the four, there really wasn't any humor in any of these movies whatsoever.
No.
Like, Nightmare had it. Friday the 13th, definitely by like the end, kind of like, you know, looking at the Jason poster in Manhattan,
mm-hmm.
The American Express card in part six. Fucking those cops in part five of Halloween. Guys are the worst.
Part two in this series had a lot of comedy. That was really it.
But
intentionally though. He went for like that.
But it was just so like, I don't know. Two was just fucking madness though. And then so let's get to the ending, which is basically that crowbar of Sally. I don't know. I don't even understand. Like, I mean, I guess I understand, but there was nothing. There was no heartstrings being pulled because it wasn't the real Marion Burns. You know,
exactly.
It wasn't like you don't see like that one character you haven't seen in 40 years come out. And I love that she gets there and brings no one. She's got to be like 100. And then these two traumatized girls are looking to get out, and they see this lady with a truck, and they're like, holy shit, we're out of here. And she's like, nah, we're hanging out. And they're like, what? Like, what's going on? And somehow a fat 85-year-old guy with a chainsaw running after her, and she has a shotgun, and she still can't pump two off like in the dialogue.
In her defense though, for an 85-year-old woman to get lifted up with a chainsaw in her midsection and completely have her guts like rearranged, not in a good way, and be able to still be alive and shoot a shotgun was insane. And I will suspend disbelief, but that was quite a reach.
If you were lifted and like you're fucking like, I don't know what's in that midsection, but I'm sure your heart, your fucking like anything that you probably need to live and breathe is getting
a lot of important shit in there.
And she was still sitting on those garbage bags, like pumping away, telling a story like, hey, listen, you can't run. It's like, what? It's like,
this is for Franklin.
How are you still alive? But yeah, you know what? If the movie was called, here's another funny thing too. Why was there water in that ending? Was there like a pool in the back somewhere? I remember when they fell into the water and Leatherface jumped out like he was Jaws. It was weird.
Septic tank.
Is that what that was? I don't even know what the fuck it was.
Well, at one point she gets covered in shit, right?
Yeah,
that was fun. That was the.
So they had some plumbing issues, clearly.
Yeah, yeah.
Roto-Rooter. Shout out to Roto-Rooter.
Yeah, I mean, listen, it was great. Like, you know, the main character was stuck under the bed, then she was stuck under the house. Really cool parts, and overall, the movie, as ridiculous as it is, you know, for it to be called Texas Chainsaw Massacre, fine. I just don't really see any connection whatsoever. Like, this could have been called literally anything.
Absolutely, that's what I thought. And put the killer with whatever. I mean, he didn't even pick up, we don't even see a chainsaw until like 40 something minutes in. Could have just been a random killer with whatever. But it's got the name, it's got the Texas Chainsaw handle that gets people interested. Would we be even talking about this if it was just a generic, whatever the fuck, you know? But like I said, like it was okay, and great kills for me. And but still, that being said, it was far from, like, a lot of people saying how bad it was, it's far from the worst Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie.
Are you kidding me? When we do our list right now, I'll tell you exactly. It landed pretty high, to be honest.
Same here. And I mean, after the credits, you know, he goes back to the house at the end of the credits. So, you know, they're setting up for a sequel or two or seven of them.
Well, they already said.
For me, there's four good Texas Chainsaw movies, and the rest is kind of just, and then there's like two glaringly bad ones, and then whatever's left is just middling away. And that's where I kind of put this.
So let's do that. Let's, you know, there's 9 movies. Let's go round robin. Give me your least favorite, Langan.
Part 4, The Beginning. The Next Generation, I'm sorry. The McConaughey, Zellweger one. It's a fucking complete mess. It's from top to bottom. There's no real story there. It's poorly acted by everybody. Even the people that went on to become something,
yeah,
they're ridiculous. Too over the top. The screaming that goes on that movie. You know, I could deal with some screams. I'd be listening to some black metal and whatever the fuck. Like, holy shit, man. I can't even take it after a while. By the time they get to the dinner table, it's excruciating to watch and listen to. And it's funny. I just joined the Joe Bob Briggs mutant Facebook page, whatever the fuck, where people are listing their favorite Chainsaw movies, because a lot of people had a problem with this one. And a lot of people are like mentioning Part 4, like it's good. I'm like, is this some like thing going on with like Halloween 3? Are people going to like start like saying Part 4 was good? Because I will fight you. That movie's a piece of shit.
It's not your last one, Parker?
It is my last one.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, all right.
Yeah, I mean, the if you want to call them positives, it's a short list.
Please give them to us.
But you got the teacher from Varsity Blues flashing out the window. That was a positive because she was pretty hot. Yeah. You got a femme mullet Leatherface. You got Budge drive-through pizzeria, which that's pretty cool. Drive-through pizzeria. Matthew McConaughey only gives you 2 all rights before they sit down for dinner. The whole fucking remote control leg war thing, that was just a fucking nightmare. And then if you go to IMDb, it's Leatherface Slaughter. That's what he was labeled as. And then the last positive was the cop that's actually questioning her in the last scene was actually the original grandpa.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
That was cool.
That's pretty cool.
Well, yeah, Leatherface was totally gender fluid in Part 4.
He was screaming the entire movie.
And in 94. Oh my God.
Leatherface's scream in that movie was the worst.
The entire movie.
It was like a pig squealing.
Yeah.
It's my last one too. What's interesting is Kim Henkel, you know, was the originator along with Toby Hooper. They wrote the screenplay together, and mad to think that Kim comes back and writes and directs this movie is like thinking of Rick Rosenthal coming back to do from Halloween 2 to do Resurrection. You're just like, wow, what happened?
I guess to call it Next Generation, they must have had like grandiose plans, like we're going to relaunch the franchise and this family's going to be like, people are going to get, you know, invested in. But
and this movie was lost. I remember like there was no release. Like eventually you found it on video and I think it was just due to the popularity of Dazed and Confused, where it's like, oh shit, like we had this guy in this movie. All right, let's release it now.
Yeah.
And it's like the insurance salesman lady that's in you know, just the worst characters, that weirdo at the end. Like this movie is up on HBO Max now, and I rewatched it and I was like, yo, this is brutal.
Bad. Yeah.
This is so brutal. Like this is so fucking goddamn brutal. So, all right. Number 8.
3D. Texas Chainsaw 3D. The only reason it ranks slightly higher than Part 4 is because of what's her name? Alexandra, whatever.
Daddario.
Daddario, yes, yeah.
Who is so fun in that
hot
movie. With hot. Black hair, looking all gothy.
Yeah, yeah.
That's literally like why this movie has elevated, like just that reason, because it's fucking terrible also. Do Your Thing, Cuz is one of the worst lines in horror history. Trey Songz is awful. We got to watch him fucking listening to his shit music while he's playing pool. It just that the character sucked. It's just not, it's another lazy movie. It's bad. And the whole tie-in with she's like this, I'll give it points also, elevating it to right above below status with the beginning with, you know, we have Bill Moseley as a young Drayton Sawyer. We have Gunnar Hansen in his last film. That whole showdown in the beginning. I actually had high hopes during that showdown in the beginning of the movie, like jumping off, like this might be something interesting. And it quickly was,
you know, that is a really good point that I was going to bring up about that movie. But yeah, I'll talk about it because it's coming up on my list. But yeah, I'll go back to that. Parker, number 8.
Same thing. I'm going 3D just because you got the hot main chick. Then you got the chick that played Nikki, who was in Lost. She was hot.
Yep.
Gunnar Hansen, who you got Marilyn Burns in this. She came back as Sally. And I don't know, man. That's pretty much all I got as far as this fucking piece of shit.
Yeah. So my number
it's got 8, the most recurring characters from the history of the franchise in one film.
There you go.
Yeah, they came back strong. But you know, my number 8 is Part 3. Part 3 is just so bad. I fucking like it. Just somehow a movie with Viggo Mortensen and Ken Foray, with effects from KNB, Carolyn Williams, aka Stretch, does a cameo. The director did Jeff Burr did, I think, 2 Puppet Masters. He did Night of the Scarecrow. Like, you know, he got the movie after it was offered to Peter Jackson, who didn't want it. But this, I just remember watching this and thinking, like, great trailer, terrible movie. Like, I didn't like I mentioned before, like, just these characters. I wanted more Hitchhiker. I wanted more Nubbins. I wanted more Chop Top. And this was just like a family of weirdos, and I fucking hated this movie so much. So that's my number 8. So 7, Langan.
I am gonna go with Leatherface, the 2017 one. It's got some positives to it, and I don't. And we're at a point in my list where I'm light years over what I think of the last 2 films I've met. You know, Leatherface isn't horrible like that. It just didn't. I thought it was an ambitious try to inject some, you know, a new telling of the story. I'll give it points for that. But I don't know. It just didn't
click for you.
Get me? Yeah, it didn't grab me at all.
I'm in the minority on that one, but we'll get to that.
Yeah.
Parker, number 7.
I actually agree with that. Leatherface for me too is next, and I'm just staring at this cover. So you got Steven Dorff, Lily Taylor, different cover mask, which was pretty cool. They tried to screw with the mask a little bit, but I don't know. Like, I bought this, literally watched it once, and it just kind of like sat there. Like, I never really had the urge to fucking rewatch it. Even doing this show, I just watch the other ones rather than this, and I was just like, oh, this is just gonna sit there and die.
I'm gonna say one day rewatch it, please.
Okay.
My 7 is 3D. I didn't know that Adam Marcus wrote the screenplay, you know, from Jason Goes to Hell fame.
I didn't either.
Yeah, that's a guy that I would like to have on the show once. But yeah, I remember watching this in the theaters and thinking to myself, what about this was 3D exactly? Like, I don't even understand. Like, maybe there was something at the end. I remember somebody throwing a chainsaw.
But he threw a chainsaw at when they get to the carnival and she's hanging on the Ferris wheel and the cop comes out. He chucks a chainsaw at him.
Yeah, it's like.
And then I could tell, like, oh, that was probably something.
That was right there. Like, there was no. I think maybe I would have enjoyed it more that way. I will say that Leatherface. First of all, let's talk about the beginning. Absolutely. There was like, so 2013, this came out, which would have made it 7 years after the last movie. So I think people were really ready for it. And they were like, hey, you know what? Let's just get rid of everything and it'll be a direct sequel to Part 1. So people hear that. They're like, okay, new beginning. Here we go. There was a lot going for this movie. And it just, yeah, I don't know. The plot was cool. Obviously, you know, being like a relative and realizing that Sawyer Carson name Alexander Daddario, I mean, just absolutely gorgeous. I can't believe Trey Songz made it in this movie. That's for sure. I don't know. But the very beginning was cool because Leatherface was kind of disgusting looking. You know, he had a very off-putting look to him for sure. He looked like he smelled disgusting. But then as the movie went on, it was just like, ah, this is not good. And it just, by the end of the movie, I'm like, please just end. And like we mentioned before, just that go get him cuz or whatever. Like,
do your thing cuz.
Like, brutal. Like, you do that and you're like, all right, you got me again. You got me to come out opening weekend to watch this piece of shit. So, all right, number six, Lane.
I am going to go with the new one. When you know, what else can I say about it? We dove deep in it stuff. Great kills, short runtime, gets to the point, but script very lacking for me. And I'm, you know, listen, I watch a lot of horror movies, obviously, and if you're a horror fan, you've watched a lot of stuff that has a lazy script or whatever and this and that, but you know, sometimes I was just hoping for a little bit more, but still worth a look, absolutely.
For sure. Parker, number seven.
I'm gonna go with The Beginning from 2006 for my next one. So you got Jordana Brewster from, you know, Fast and the Furious fame right there, sitting on a road trip with her and the boyfriend and another couple before they're actually going to Vietnam. So this was the prequel where you see, you know, R. Lee kill the sheriff and take over the character, which I thought was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Andrew Borynarski comes back to, you know, revive the role of Leatherface. And I don't know. I mean, these seconds, whatever you want to call them, second batch of movies kind of, they kind of stand on their own, like, whereas, you know, the first two kind of intertwine. This is kind of like a whole different set, which, you know, if you're gonna watch these, watch them together, obviously. But this one was did pretty well in the theater from what I remember. I mean, it had a pretty big opening weekend, and same thing. I mean, typical, you know, pretty brutal kills. You know, if you know the story about Texas Chainsaw Massacre, it's really nothing new, even though it's, you know, kind of introduce, you know, him as the sheriff. But that's pretty much it. I don't remember anything standing out. That's probably why this is so low on my list, but definitely worth a watch.
Yeah, so that's my number six as well. I know that it was directed by this guy, Jonathan Liebson. He did some interesting movies. He did, I think, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle movie from 2014, Battle Los Angeles. yeah, I like this. Like, this and part, you know, the beginning really look cool. They were very connected. There's a scene in the beginning where I guess Leatherface kind of like loses his shit as he's working in like the butcher place, and he like hammers this dude's like legs.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty brutal. I like that. And now, what I don't like about Platinum Dune movies, which I'm sure I've mentioned before, is just the sound effects. I don't like that. Like when you watch the first movie, like, somebody gets hit over the head with a mallet, it's like cool. When they do it in these newer movies, it's like someone is like sitting in a studio, like banging like a file cabinet or something into a mic. It's like, go, 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 go. And you're like, what the fuck? Like, it takes you so out of it. Like, it's just that Michael Bay flavor that fucking kind of ruins it. That's why these movies will be lower down on my list. But yeah, it's cool. I like Jordana Brewster, you know, very attractive. And she was good in this. I like the characters. They were greasy enough. But also, this and the other one, that just as far as casting, they were definitely of that era where they got like clean cut looking people and maybe put like a little makeup on them. So, but still very fun. Up on, I think, Netflix right now. So anyone that never caught The Beginning, it's actually pretty good. So, Lang at number five.
I got Part Three from 1990 there. Definitely all your complaints about it, totally valid. Totally agree with you. I guess I think I have a bit of a nostalgic spot in my heart for this film. I remember seeing it. I was, you know, a junior in high school. I remember seeing it in the theater. We were all psyched to see it, and it kind of sits with me. I love that it's got Ken Foray in it, who is just one of my favorite horror actors. And I was super excited when Death Angel was in it. It's a metal movie.
Yeah, you know? It is a pretty fucking metal movie. You're right.
It's a metal movie, so that it sits highly. But it does the drawbacks of it. Yeah, there's some bad characters in it. Viggo doesn't really fit, and it does take a long time to get to the action. Those are drawbacks of it, but got a spot in my heart.
Yeah, cool. So Parker, number five.
I'm going to go with the new one for part five. And I pretty much touched on everything with that. Just the violence that that hammer scene with the leg, man, really stood out for me. When that leg got fucking bent back, I probably had to rewind that a couple times. And holy shit, it's a brutal movie. There's some really great fucking kills in that. I mean, even if you hate this franchise and everything, just go in for the fucking brutality and just fucking shut up and sit there for 83 minutes.
Did Sarah shut up and sit there for 83 minutes?
Not really. She was just like, oh, that's stupid and this and that. Oh, another good scene was when the black girl was trying to get out of the bus and he sawed her in half and the fucking top half of her. That scene, she was just like, cool. She's like, that's disgusting. I was like, no, that's cool. That's fucking cool is what that is.
Well, yeah, that's the whole point. It should be disgusting.
Yeah,
like if you get sawed in half, it should.
Yeah, retrospect, what you really wanted to do is climb over a couple of seats.
Yeah,
you could have got past them and run out the door. But you know, hindsight's always 20/20.
Yeah, you know.
My number five is 2003, the remake, Jessica Biel. I mean, listen, you know, not to harp on her appearance, but she's very attractive, and we were all, you know, I was, I don't know, probably 25 and probably in love with her back then for sure.
Still am number one, baby. Number one coming at you.
What did she do? She did that TV
Seventh
show,
Heaven.
Right?
She did Seventh Heaven, and then a little fun fact right here. So then she posed for that men's magazine Stuff, which was like the B side of Maxim. And
yes, I remember that. Yep.
Had some racy pictures, and Seventh Heaven was ran by like a Christian production company. So they actually kicked her off because of the pictures.
But left on the child molesting father, right?
Yeah. Molester? Yep. Yep.
You gotta love it.
That guy gets Christianity.
Yeah, yeah. We'll give him a raise.
That guy could say you gotta go. But I thought she was, maybe I'm thinking of someone else. Who was the girl in that Channel 11 show where she was with Kevin Murphy, Unhappily Ever After, or right?
Yeah, she went out with, who did she go out with? Bobcat Goldthwait, maybe?
Yeah.
Oh, the redheaded chick.
I'm going to look that up right now. Yep, Unhappily Ever After.
Jamie, look that up.
Jamie's looking it up now. Oh, I'm thinking of Nikki Cox.
Yes, the redheaded chick. She was in Maxim, too. What a surprise.
All right. Well, listen, shout out to Beale anyway. So there's
Jay Moore. She's married. She was married to Bobcat.
The director of this movie, Marcus Nipsel, German guy. And he did this remake, which I thought was great. And then he did the Friday the 13th one like 6 years later.
Yes. Yeah.
But this one, the cinematographer, I believe it's still Daniel Pearl. I think Daniel Pearl from the original movie did the cinematography for this movie, which makes a lot of sense. The female hitchhiker in this, like when she blows her head off,
you see
bullet hole, like that's some really cool fucking stuff.
That was a good shot.
Yeah. And
no pun intended.
Yeah. Hey man, nice shot.
Yeah.
But this was great. This was a lot of fun. And once again, I think this one is also up on Netflix. It was a really good 1-2 punch for these two movies. Once again, the only thing that I will continue to knock is just the style of Platinum Dunes. You know, like I'm not like a hater of their shit, but it's just like I don't really think their style is very conducive to horror movies that I gravitate towards. But they did a really good job with these, and probably the best out of like the remakes, the big four remakes.
Definitely.
Sure. Yeah, I'll piggyback right on that, man. My number four is the same film, that remake from 2003. it was a, you know, remakes, especially, I think that the whole hostility of remakes has gotten a little bit less, but there was a big, you know, pushback on, and some of them were good films. This was one of them, you know, Hills of Eyes. It's been done, you know what I mean? So, but yeah, it's, it, to take on such a great film like that, and do this good of a job with it, I got to tip my cap. And Arlie Ermey, and I just can't say enough about him. What he brings to and elevates the film, you know, it's, I could listen to that guy read anything, man. He just has a certain unbelievable delivery. He had a hostility. It's just a great character too, to introduce a new character into the franchise at that point, you know what I mean? And have it be that good. It's a rarity, because a lot of times that could fall flat on its face, but he brings it.
And, he did. He did it.
It's great. And yeah, her white tank top should be and that's as famous as, you know, Jason's hockey mask. It's up there in history.
It's up there for sure. And you're right, that he did bring a character that was memorable, you know, like from the hitchhiker to Chop Top. And I think he would definitely be in the consideration for the next slot, which is very hard to do amongst us, you know, especially the many different flavors of Leatherface that we've gotten. Yep. So Parker, number four.
I am also going to go with Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake for my number four. And I will once again talk about Jessica Biel's white tank top, about how she fell into a puddle. And then for the next 2 minutes, that shirt was just wet and soaked to her 88 pound body.
She was on the run for a while at the end.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was a long chase.
Yeah. So the actor that played Leatherface in this, Andrew Bernarski, I actually saw him at a convention, met him at a convention, and what an asshole. I mean, right up there with fucking Tom Savini, like asshole, like just cared about the money, like give me the money, next, blah, blah, blah. So this guy went on a diet of brisket and white bread to gain 30 pounds for this role, which that sounds pretty fucking good to me right now. Sign me up. And this movie is banned in the Ukraine, I found out. There's the body count is 8 people. We had an opening budget of $9.5 million, and it grossed $80 million US. So I think it definitely did pretty well, this movie. And another fun fact was, 4 bands that were on the soundtrack, Nothing Face, Motor Grader, Shallows Fall, and Sworn Enemy, all played Ozfest that year.
Very cool. Yeah, yeah. You know, just a message to Tom Savini. Obviously, whatever Parker says has nothing to do with the show.
Oh, so I would let that slide if we could get him on.
If you're listening to this, you know.
And I know you are. Mm-hmm.
I know you are.
Even if Leatherface is listening, let's let bygones be bygones. Right. We'll talk higher learning. We'll talk the program, whatever you want to talk about.
We'll talk brisket and white bread.
Yeah, no problem.
So my number four is 2022. Yeah, listen, mixed into this batch, like I objectively looked at it and I'm like, did I enjoy it more than 2003, 2006, 3D part 3 and part 4? Absolutely. Did I enjoy it as much as I enjoyed the top 3? No. So it's going to sit at number 4 just for the violence, and, you know, the couple of absurdity things that I could overlook, and the fact that it did very well, like number 2 debut for Netflix is a big thing. And they're already, you know, they were talking about like the sequel plans, because obviously with that ending, I'm glad. I mean, the fact that's another funny thing was that the ending was a little funny.
Tesla. Well,
you're just sitting there. It's like, all right, automatic pilot, cool. We'll just sit here. And she's like, let me get some air. And I was just like, all right, I see what's happening here. She rolls down the window. I'm like, as soon as you roll down the window, I'm thinking like, oh, she's done.
Yeah.
And she gets yanked out, and I'm like, yeah, but I liked it. It was pretty fun.
And decapitated.
Yeah.
And I feel like a lot of people waited the whole movie for that to happen, you know.
And they gave you the last stab at nostalgia. They gave you the dance.
The dance.
The chainsaw dance.
Which
dance of the chainsaws. The
I'm not gonna lie, Mark Burnham, who plays Leatherface in that movie, I don't think he got the dance quite right, but
that's one of a kind.
Yeah,
exactly. That's lightning in a bottle right there with Gunnar Hansen.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like Underdog, basically, from the Howard Stern show. You know, only she could pull off something. You know, but that's my number four. So top three, here we go, Langan.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre: The Beginning.
Wow, look at you.
Yeah, I like the hot
take.
Hot take. Well, yeah, I know you got a hot take at number three too.
I do.
I like this one. I for a couple of reasons. Again, Lee R. Ermey crushing it. I give it higher marks than the remake because it's not a remake; it's a prequel, and it gives a little. I like the scene in the slaughterhouse. I like showing like how the family got to the position they were in.
Yeah,
you know, losing the job and you know, relying on eating people, I guess, to live. Which, by the way, too, like I'm not a chef or anything, but preparing your meat, cutting it with a chainsaw, probably not the best way to preserve a nice cut of meat. But he seems to like it nonetheless. But anyway, I like, you know, Jordana Brewster's fine, Dierra Baird, amazing. But I just like the whole origin story. I like them trying to take a new shot because this is the first prequel
that
was ever taken in this series. So I liked it. And I remember going, I went to a horror convention that year where they did a panel too. And they were all there. And Lee R. Ermey, I keep saying Lee R. Ermey, he was fantastic in this panel. Like you could just listen to that guy talk and tell stories or whatever. And have a little moment with him because his mother had just passed and my mother had just passed. So I was talking with the table. What a great guy. Fantastic guy. So this movie, like, really, I have just fond memories of that whole time in that movie, but I like them for trying to not just rehash something, but, you know, put a little life into it.
Yeah. They, you know, on the rewatch, I was going back and forth between putting 2003 behind it, you know, and like I was flip flopping them, but I'm like, let me just leave it at that. Cause
they work well together as a two piece though, like two films together, you know?
Yeah. Like they're not like, if you're at a certain age where you don't want to watch something from the 70s and don't really get the 80s, that's a good, you know, if you're like a 25-year-old or 20-year-old and, you know, that might be your movie. You're like, okay, I like these two more than the original. So, yeah. Good stuff. Parker, number three.
Number three, I'm forever, you know, sticking up for this movie, and I'm going with Leatherface Part Three, which is this is the Mark Schoenbach edition, which he did for Cavity.
I was going to say, I never saw that artwork.
For Gutter Garbs.
Nice.
And, I mean, you got Ken Foray, as we all know. You got William Butler, who was from the Night of the Living Dead remake, who played Tommy in that. I mean, you got Viggo Mortensen as this character Tex, which, you know, that was right up there with, you know, Laleen from Carlito's Way. You know, he can't walk, he can't hump, you know.
Who got else? Nothing, man.
Yeah, you know, you got
fucking wheelchair.
Yeah, you got this guy Tom Everett playing just this straight up weirdo Alfredo, who just, you know, you don't know if this guy's a pedophile or what, but this is the guy that, you know, when they cut the body parts up, that this poor bastard has to go down there and dump like arms and legs and shit in the fucking river to get rid of them. And you got Tony Hudson, who played this chick Sarah, who I guess, I don't know if she's escaped from the family or what, but all I know is that she was in Just One of the Guys, so that was good enough for me. And I mean, the trailer, I still remember the trailer for this movie. You know, it was you know, just you had this lake, and then next thing you know, this hand pops up with this chainsaw, and it looks like Excalibur, and it just says the Saw's family, Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3, Leatherface. And I was like, holy fucking shit, here we go.
Here we go. And then you watch the movie and you're like, this is terrible.
Love it. Love it. I will.
First movie the Saw's family thing came up, right?
Yeah.
So it gets points for that because like a legacy.
I will forever stick up for this movie.
Yeah. Well, that's how I feel about my number three.
Yeah.
My number three is 2017's Leatherface. Now, this was written and directed by Julian Maury and Alexandra Bustillo, who did one of the best movies of all time, which was Inside. You know, once I heard they were attached to this, I was like, this is great. And they really, so the success of 3D, I think 3D, the budget might have been like 20 million, and I think the box office was like 50. So they were like, oh, okay, after 7 years of laying dormant, the franchise, they're like, okay, you know, it got revitalized. And they pitched a prequel, and this was the prequel that they came up with. And you know, what people don't like is, I guess they kind of went away from the folklore that they attached to Leatherface, and it's just I guess like almost, it starts off as a revenge story. Stephen Dorff is like a sheriff, and his daughter gets killed by like the Sawyer family. And then from there, he takes some of their kids away, you know, like CPS style and shit, and puts them in a home. And then from there, they escape and they go on this run, and they're running from Stephen Dorff, and Lily Taylor plays Verna Sawyer Carson. So it's pretty tied into 3D, which I really didn't even pay attention or had an idea. But this, it was just great. It was just very violent. In the very beginning, you see Grandpa killing someone with a hammer, you know, the way they said he did. And it's just, it was very gross, very disgusting, a lot like pure violence, the way the French do it. And that's what I really took away from it. I think there was like this detachment, maybe the way some people looked at the Rob Zombie Halloween, me included, that it's just like, this isn't the Halloween that I know. I think some people looked at Leatherface 2017 and they're like, this isn't the movie or the characters that I know. But once you get by that, it's really good. It's a really good horror movie. It's like a chase movie, but the gore and the violence is great. The ending is fucking fantastic. So huge fan of part of whatever 2017. So that's my number three. So cool. Top two, I'm sure we all know what we got. So let's do it. Langan.
My part two is part two. Texas Chainsaw Massacre part two from 86. It's a lot of humor, but a lot of savagery too. One of my favorite scenes of the entire series or in horror is the scene in the radio station with Chop Top. Bill Moseley knocks it out of the park. And one of my biggest gripes with the Chainsaw franchise is that's all we ever got at Chop Top. That character could have been of legend. He was so great. And great soundtrack in this movie. The scene with the preppies at the beginning. I love that scene. Driving down that bridge that's longer than the George Washington Bridge, but it looks like a little overpass.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's just so much of a fun movie. And Dennis Hopper, completely unhinged, like completely insane. Stephen Dorff was pretty unhinged in that one, but not, Hopper was just out of his freaking mind, like,
yeah,
in this film. And I get the vibe he got there. He took the role and just like, I'm going to do whatever the fuck I want with this. Like, and you're going to like it. And that's it, you know? Yeah. And it works. I love this movie. I love this movie forever. Now, if you're a younger person, like you said, 20s or whatever, and you might like those early 2000s Chainsaw reboots, this is probably a movie like that people would not like, you know? And I would understand why. But for me, it scratches the itch.
Yeah, if you're a gigantic pussy, you might not like this movie. So.
If granted. You're a fucking asshole.
Yeah, if you're a fucking asshole and a pussy, yeah, you probably would hate this, so avoid it, you know.
Yeah,
but then again, you're probably not listening either.
No.
So number two, Parker.
Same thing, man. Number part two, I gotta go with I mean, tons of humor in this fucking movie. I mean, this movie really should be like celebrated like a fucking Kiss Meets the Phantom. It's just like a fucking funny, like is it good, like not really, but like it's still a fucking, like, you know what you're gonna get going into this. I mean, everything from like the chili cook-off, like this guy's a fucking mass murderer, he's driving around in this goddamn truck like entering chili competitions. I mean, anything from that to like Dennis Hopper like going to fucking go chainsaw shopping, and like so much fucking funny shit in this. But then again, like, but then like the brutality of like we said, you know, like Chop Top's walking around with like this plate in his fucking head that he got from like Vietnam or wherever the fuck he got it from. And, you know, he's lighting up the fucking, you know, the thing to scratch the itch. And I mean, the incoming mail, that guy must, I think I counted at one time, it was like 53 hits or something. The guy gets to the head, and just a fucking fun movie throughout. And I mean, I remember first time I saw this, when I saw her at the end doing the fucking chainsaw dance, I was just like, oh man, like, is she going to become the Leatherface? Like, is she going to like take over that role now? I always thought that, but obviously, you know, we didn't get that.
You know, whenever it comes to things like that, I don't think fans like that.
Mm.
You know, like they wanted to do that with part five with Tommy. They wanted to do that.
Yeah.
With Danielle Harris and Halloween 4. Like, when it comes to that, it's like, well, I don't want to see, I want to see, you know, Leatherface, mm-hmm. or, you know, so, but okay. That's your number two. My number two hot take is Texas Chainsaw Massacre Part 1.
Mm. What?
Yeah. And I'll tell you exactly why. You know, I'm looking at it from the perspective of like, what do I want to watch over and over again? You know, so what movie have I seen out of the first two? What movie do I go back to? It's two the most, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But one you could say is probably the greatest horror movie of all time. Like, you can't argue that point because it's just pure insanity. From the hitchhiker being just disgusting. Mm. Just so fucking gross. Like, I remember just watching that scene with him in the van and that face that he's making. And you're just like, yo, like, this isn't I don't know. Like, I just saw him and I'm like, I never want to meet this person in my life. He's just so gross. To just, you know, being put on a hook and there's really no blood to it. There's no, it's just like, you're like, oh yeah, if you get put on a hook, that's probably what you're going to look like. If you're going to get hit in the head with a fucking mallet. And then the ending, of course, the ending, like the dinner scene with them is just so fucking nuts because of the camera work from Toby Hooper. You just catch, I just feel like all of them were probably going insane because it was so hot and smelled so gross. They were just like, yeah, they're like, we're like, we are going crazy right now. And I think they just live that moment. And it, you know, when we talk about 2022 or any sequel from this franchise, I think what makes it very hard is just the, you're always going to be compared to part one, and part one is just too high of a bar, which is why Toby Hooper makes part two, because he's like, I can't even top part one, so I got to go backwards. So anything that ever comes from here is always going to be like, okay, well, 74 was the best, and it's like, okay, you're right, you're completely right. So that's the Halloweenism. It's like, okay, it's like, is it scarier than the first one? No. It's like, all right, so I don't even know what to do. Friday the 13th, the original, okay. You know, it was just like whatever. Nightmare on Elm Street is still good, but they I feel like that those franchises got better as they went on a little bit. Texas Chainsaw Massacre is just a movie that, you know, will always just stand. But when I think of the movie that I want to watch over and over again, or the movie that I have, it's not part one. So that's why it's my number two.
Yeah. Fair enough.
All right.
All right.
So you guys both talk about part one and then I'll say part two.
It, for me, part one, it's my favorite horror movie of all time. It's I think it's high art to me. It's beyond, it's a perfect horror movie. The fact that there is no gore in it and people thought it was such a gory movie, like you read like reviews from back in the day, is how powerful it was. And what makes it so, and that's, and another reason why a lot of films get measured, it's so gritty and grindhousey, and you feel the heat, you feel the sweat of Texas. Everything is disgusting, greasy. You're like sweat. Anything slightly glossy, that how films are made, you know, just from a look, you can't recapture that. That's lightning in a bottle, not to just use that term again, but it it's everything that I like about that era of film is that grindhouse grit to it. And the way it was shot, and Toby Hooper just, you know, made a piece of perfect art, you know? And I mean, I was seeing it as a young kid, I was scared as shit. Cause I thought, you know, the part with Larroquette Reeves and based on a true story, and we know it's like Ed Gein and whatever and like that, but like, I believe that shit. Like, I thought something was like off. And when you mentioned like the hitchhiker, man, that dude like creeped me. Like, I thought that I couldn't believe that that guy could be an actor.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I thought like that guy is clearly mentally ill. Like, there's no way that guy's putting that on, you know? And
yeah.
And let's talk about, and one of the best scenes in horror history, when the first time we see Leatherface, when the guy goes into the house and he emerges from that room and hits him with that hammer. And it's not just some clean kill where the guy just hits with a knife and falls down. No, we show the feet spazzing out like it would, like if your nervous system was collapsing like that. It was utterly savage. And then just how he grabs the door and slams it shut, and it's got also this real like industrial kind of like, not a score or soundtrack, but like sound,
it's like noise.
Yes,
it's like,
it works,
yeah,
with it, because it's almost metallic like a chainsaw.
Yeah.
And yeah, let's talk about just the name Texas Chainsaw Massacre, a plus name. Like, I mean, it's perfect. It rolls off the tongue. I can't say enough about it. It's my favorite. What can I say?
And it influenced the scene in Scarface with the chainsaw.
Nice.
I'm just kidding. I don't
fun
know.
Facts.
I'm just kidding. I mean,
Chichi, get the yayo. Come on, Chichi.
You know, if you ask me, maybe so. Let me try. I'm just putting this filter on for no reason.
I like that. Yeah, it's a movie theater right there.
Hi guys. Parker, tell me about your number one.
So going with the original 74, just to piggyback off of that, it's like what Langan said, like it's just dirty. Like, you feel like you need a shower after this movie, you need like a nap, a fucking vacation, like you just want to be left alone after watching this. I always, you know, recommend, I think it's still on Tubi right now, called The Texas Chainsaw Massacre: Family Portrait Revisited. I always urge people to watch this, because they get the original, well, most of the original cast, and they interview them, and they just talk about like what hell they put themselves through physically, mentally, financially, making this movie, how fucking nobody got pretty much anything at the end of the day, you know, paid for. And
they had to work with Franklin.
Yes, yes. And just talking about like, you know, the hell that it was. I mean, that dinner scene, I think, took like 24 hours to film, and just like the horror on their face, like that's what they were going through physically and mentally. Like, nobody was sleeping for days, and just, you know, so I mean, to capture that on screen, I think, is just amazing, and you're never going to get that out of any of these other ones.
Joe Bob Briggs' favorite horror movie of all time as well.
There you go,
Joe Bob Briggs. Okay, yeah, so then, you know, my number one is just Part Two. You know, we are named after it. And there's just, you know, Canon Films. Like, it's just so funny that Canon put this out, to be honest with you. the Breakfast Club setup, you know, which is just ridiculous to begin with. The opening, that guy's head getting sawed in half. Those stupid glasses. Why were they so annoying on the phone, by the way? You know,
the 3D glasses, yeah.
Why were they so annoying? That bridge scene, like that bridge was like the size, like the size of a driveway. But like, if you watch the movie, that it's like they drove like 30 miles on it or something,
yeah,
and they were still on that bridge. I don't know why. Like, why would that be like an option to do? But they're like, fuck it. They're like, we can't leave this bridge.
Yeah, it didn't have to be on a bridge.
It didn't
just be on a road.
Yeah,
it didn't like mean it. Well, they went off the bridge right once they got cut, I guess, and then they went. But yeah, you could have went another direction.
Yeah, you could have ended up on the bridge, I guess. But they were like,
I love the song they're playing during that scene.
Yeah.
Too.
Oh yeah.
Is that Oingo Boingo?
It was. Yes. Yeah. Yep.
Great song.
You know, like you mentioned before, when I talk about tension scenes, The most tense scenes in movies. One that comes to mind is, of course, Boogie Nights, the firecracker scene.
Yep.
There's also another scene in the movie Sicario, where there's a checkpoint and that checkpoint scene is fucking tense. Like, you're like, holy shit. Like, anyone who's seen that movie knows what I'm talking about. And then one of the other movies that I can mention is the radio scene in Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, because you know something's going to happen. You know that Chop Top looks like a complete fucking lunatic, and all he's trying to do is like kill time by asking Stretch all these questions. And you're just like, what is going on?
It's lit really well too.
It's lit that scene. So nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
Dennis Hopper buying chainsaws. Like, every good action movie has that scene where the, you know, like James Bond goes to look for weapons, or like Arnold Schwarzenegger, like, you know, like goes to
Commando, the hidden room.
Yeah. It's just like, okay. And you're like, oh my God, he's going to kill 100 like people from Panama right now. Or some shit, like wherever.
And how excited was that old man watching him?
Yeah. Yeah.
Baby.
Yeah. He's just like,
I'm pretty sure he like dropped the load or something.
And his
he was so happy.
Yeah,
we should all be so lucky to have someone look at us the way that he looks at Dennis Hopper.
But yeah, he had the two little chainsaws to the side. He had the big one. Yeah, it was just absolutely absurd, like completely fucking absurd. And I think if you want to pick the worst weapon on the planet, it's probably a chainsaw, because I feel like they jam up and they don't really
jam up. You got to make sure you got fuel.
Yeah.
You know, they're cumbersome.
Yeah.
It's
You can't even, like, I mean, you could hit someone with it, but that's about it. Like, you get one good whack and it's probably very heavy to like swing around. But you know, once they get to the lair, it's just, yeah, this movie is just great. And the fact that we never got All American Massacre, which was going to be the sequel. Do you know about All American Massacre, right?
I don't think so. No.
Oh wow. Okay. All American Massacre is an unreleased film directed by William Tony Hooper, which is obviously Toby's son. So it's a sequel to part two, and from what I recall, I guess Chop Top is on death row. And they start filming this movie, and there's still some footage of it, but it was just never released. Look it up. There's like a trailer to it.
Oh wow!
And it's pretty interesting. Yeah, I thought you guys would have known that for sure.
No, I didn't know that, but I love Chop Top.
Yes,
I have an autograph from Bill Moseley up hanging up my office.
Nice.
Where he signed "Lick My Plate, You Dog Dick."
Well, we almost got him until, you know, his manager was like, "How many listeners do you have?" And we're like, "2."
Yeah, one's in England. Don't worry.
Yeah, like 2, 1. I could definitely verify.
You know, should have been like, what's the minimum?
Yeah,
we need, because that's the number we have.
Yeah.
Yeah. That number.
That number right there. Oh yeah, for sure. Can you send that over to me? You're like, yeah. Let me just get some white out. But yeah, that's it. So cool. Great franchise. Probably my least favorite of the four, to be honest with you. The ones that I watched the least. But on this go around, it's funny because I enjoyed a lot of these a lot more than I did in the theater for some of them, except for 4 and 3, which are just complete dog shit. Hey Parker, in fairness, I did watch 1990, so you didn't watch 20. You should watch 2017 again, because it's really good.
I got it on DVD, so I might break that out.
It's an interesting one for me, because it's, like I said, it's my favorite horror movie of all time, but the franchise is a mess, you know.
Yeah,
the franchise.
I don't know if it's as, I mean, they all have, you know, Halloween, there's certain ones that Halloween might be the best, probably, overall.
Yeah, minus Resurrection, I think Halloween is my favorite franchise.
Pound for pound, you know.
Yeah,
and there's
yeah.
worse ones than Texas Chainsaw. I mean, Hellraiser is a fucking disaster.
Oh, Hellraiser, I gave up after, you know, 3. Mean? So
there's
like,
so many.
They go to Outer Space in number 4, then by like the 6th one, the guy's on Weight Watchers and like Fat Pinhead.
So there's a lot of shitty franchises out there, but you know.
Yeah, but I you know, the worst one here which we all agree is four. Yeah. I feel it looks like The Godfather next to Resurrection.
Yeah.
Halloween.
Yes.
Or yeah, that's it really. Like, cause even like the worst Nightmare on Elm Street, which is probably six. And the worst Friday the 13th is probably Jason Takes Manhattan.
I go with X.
X yeah. too. I go with like, but either one of the like X is pretty brutal to watch.
Resurrection yeah. or Texas Chainsaw Part 4 are the two worst movies in the big four.
Yeah. Universe. Oh, without a doubt.
Although, yeah. Unless we're Nightmare on Elm Street remake was pretty fucking brutal.
Well, yeah. If we get into remakes, yeah,
we're getting into remakes. The remake is just terrible.
I still never even made it through the Nightmare on Elm Street remake. I shut it off like half an hour in.
But of non-remakes, Texas Chainsaw 4 and Resurrection, that's the bottom of the fucking barrel.
Yeah. I had to sit through Nightmare remake because I went to the theaters to watch it.
Mm.
It was. I always say that out of all the movies that. Listen, when I go pay to see a movie, I'm never leaving. I'm watching it from beginning to end. The only time I was ever tempted to leave was during that movie. Mm. Also, the movie Mirrors was pretty bad. And the movie Silent Hill. Those were three movies I was sitting in the theater watching going like, I don't care how this ends. Yeah. And my popcorn just finished, and like, if my girlfriend wanted to leave, we could leave. Like, but
yeah.
I almost did it on Rob Zombie's Halloween Part 2. We did do it on Boogeyman, this movie Boogeyman.
Yes, yeah, I remember.
Some generic, whatever. Yeah. We did walk out of that, but yeah, it's great. Nowadays, Wikipedia. Shout out to Wikipedia, because then there's a movie that's so bad you don't want to finish it. Yeah. But you're kind of curious to see what happens. You go to that plot summary. Boom. Ah. Okay. That's what they did. Boom.
All they right. do. They okay. do a good plot summary. So
I walked out of Batman and Robin. That's the only movie I ever left with. Once fucking Mr. Freeze came out and like the go-go bat roller skates and shit. I'm like, I'm out later.
Yeah. Yeah. That was a pretty brutal one too.
Horrible.
cool. All right. So we'll put this out. And I don't know. I guess we got a bunch of shit coming up. So I will see you guys.
Cool.
Later.